Once we have these values in place, there are certain inevitabilities that begin to flow. And one of these inevitabilities is that liberals will become political collectivists, whereas conservatives will become political individualists. So let's talk about this side first. Political individualism is a theory that says that each human being is unique, with their own hopes and dreams and beliefs and desires and goals. And therefore, each human being should be treated as though they are unique. They should be dignified as such. Now, in practice, this means that each person should be given freedom, the individual freedom to express their own individuality. They should be afforded the freedom to think and speak and act however they wish, to pursue their own goals in any way they choose. Within the boundaries of the law, of course, and as long as it doesn't impinge on someone else's freedom to do the same thing. But apart from that, they are free to express their individuality, to speak, to think, to pursue their own goals in any way they choose. So freedom therefore becomes intrinsic to the conservative worldview. We can add that to the conservative side now. Individualism and freedom are inextricably linked. Whenever there is individuality, there must be freedom to express that individuality. Conservatives believe that people should be free to pursue life, liberty, and happiness in any way they choose. And that's maybe even the essence of conservatism right there. Now, as we've been learning over the past couple of episodes, though, whenever people are free to speak their own unique thoughts or assert their individuality in any way whatsoever, it causes conflict. If we think back to Bob at the party when he spoke his own mind about immigration and Jesus, it caused conflict because each individual at the party had their own unique ideas, so there were arguments. Then we saw in the last episode that when people pursue their individual goals in the sports field or in the business world, it brings them into conflict, that is competition with other individuals as well. Individualism always produces conflict. Now again, as we saw in the last couple of episodes, conservatives don't mind that conflict because they see the advantages of it. When people are getting into verbal conflict, that is debate with one another, we learn to see different points of view, we learn to separate good ideas from bad ones, and we grow in wisdom and knowledge and education. When there's competition on the sports field, again, conflict on the sports field and in business, it builds character, all of these great things that we saw earlier on. So the conservative attitude is let people be free to express themselves, let them think their own thoughts, their own unique thoughts, let them speak their own mind, let them pursue their own goals in their own way. And yes, there will be conflict as a result of that, but it will all be worth it in the end. In fact, you could say that societies can only advance where there is room for some kind of individualism. Every leap forward that civilization has ever taken has tended to have come because there was some individual who saw the world in a completely unique way. They had this vision that nobody else had ever had before, and they were given the freedom to pursue that goal, to pursue that vision in their own way. Leonardo da Vinci, Galileo, Einstein, Newton, Tesla, they all saw the world in these completely unique ways like nobody else ever had. They had the freedom to pursue their visions, to pursue their goals, and in doing so, they created a better future for everyone. In fact, I've just been reminded of a Sherman Brothers song that really kind of summarizes what I'm trying to say here. Disney used it for the Carousel of Progress in Walt Disney World, but it really summarizes what I'm trying to say, so let's play it.
There's a great, big, beautiful tomorrow, and tomorrow's just a dream away. Man has a dream, and that's the start. He follows his dream with mind and heart. And when it becomes a reality, it's a dream come true for you and me.
One individual has a unique dream, and that's the start. They have the freedom to follow that dream with their mind and heart. And when it becomes a reality, everyone benefits. You'll find that the most innovative societies are the ones that value individualism, the ones that give freedom to people to go pursue their hopes and their dreams and their goals, and out of that, genius stuff can happen. So again, freedom, though, is a very important conservative value. There's even a case for saying that it's the most important conservative value, the thing that conservatives care the most about. It's certainly vying with truth at the top spot, so we'll put it up to number two for now to emphasize its importance to conservatives. Liberals, on the other hand, as we already know, do not believe that the conflict of individualism is worth it. Their priority is unity, and that makes liberals political collectivists. Collectivists believe that we are not mere atomized individuals functioning independently of one another, pursuing our own hopes and dreams and getting into conflict and competition. They think that's quite a selfish way to live. But instead, they think that we are each best seen as just small pieces of a larger collective idea called society. We're each just small cogs in a much larger machine. And if that machine, if that society is to function harmoniously, then unity is the most important thing. They believe that individual goals and speech should be sacrificed for the cause of the greater good. The cohesive unity of the collective is more important than individual expression, which can so often be disruptive. Which is why Bob's boss shut him down at the party, and it's why Irish schools are trying to eliminate competitive sports. It's all done in the name of collective cohesion being the most important thing. Now, you may notice that the individualist worldview requires very little by way of government. If people are to be left free to speak their own minds and pursue their own personal goals, then it's up to those individuals to form their own opinions and decide what their goals are going to be and make their own plans on how to achieve them. They require very little in the way of government interference. The individualist, in fact, really only wants one thing from their government, and that is to be left alone as much as possible. Indeed, at the extreme end of individualism, you will come to the political idea of anarchy, which is no government at all. If you think of it as a sliding scale, at the far end you've got anarchy, then as you move towards the center, you will encounter libertarianism, who want a little bit of government, but very, very minimal. Then as you pass through the center, you will notice that if you get into the left-hand side, the liberal dream of unity starts to require quite a bit of government. So no government, less government, quite a bit of government. And then if you go to the extreme end on the left, you get into huge government. After all, if group synchronization is your ultimate goal, but we're all individuals trying to do our own thing and pursue our own paths, you need somebody to bring that all together and to choreograph the group and to give them a common direction. It's like an orchestra. You need a conductor for everyone to play in harmony, otherwise it's just a bunch of individual instruments playing a discordant noise. For these individuals to synchronize, you need a conductor. Actually, what I can do to highlight this is show how parachute games work. So in the last episode, I played this clip as an example of cooperative play, but I turned the audio off. But in order for this group to move in such harmony and in such unison, I'll play it again with the audio and listen very carefully. Notice the presence of a choreographer here, namely the teacher.
Hold. Squat. On your toes, not on your knees. Umbrella. Nice job. No steps yet. I didn't say it. Put it back down. Okay. All right, stand up, make some waves. Hold. Squat. Now this time, listen for how many steps we're going to take. Okay. Umbrella. One step. Back out. Nice job. Okay, listen for the steps again.
And that's how it continues. You see, in order for those kids to move in harmony, they need a top-down power calling the shots, telling them what to do and when to do it. Go in one step, come out one step. Go in three steps, come out three steps. Wait, not yet. Now you can do it. These kids become robots or puppets. They're merely following the orders of this top-down authority. Whenever you see individuals moving in harmony like this, there's always that authority present. There's always that choreographer calling the shots, telling people what to do and when to do it. Now, in a societal sense, of course, that authority is the government. And the deeper you go into that side, the more power that authority gains to control and coordinate and tell people what to do. So whereas the extreme of individualism is no government at all, the extreme of collectivism is huge government, authoritarian government, government with far-reaching intrusive powers to control and dictate every aspect of an individual's life. The further you go into that side, the more people become puppets of the state. They decide what people think and what they say and what they do. So if you think of far-left governments like China or North Korea, that's a good example. The individuals in those societies don't have personal freedom to speak their own mind. They are just cogs in a machine dictated to by the powers that be. They are puppets of the machine. And this is all done, of course, again, in the name of creating group cohesion and group unity. If anyone shows a sign of individual expression that may threaten to destabilize the group, they're swiftly dealt with. In North Korea, the state even decides what kind of haircut you're allowed to have. And if you deviate from that, then the authorities will take you out. They'll put you in concentration camps, they'll kill you, because they don't want any individual disruption to the group unity, which is considered sacrosanct. The collective is always more important than the individual on this side. And individuals are considered dangerous to group unity.
The North Korean education system is designed to turn out disciplined, devoted citizens with a heavy focus on the group over the individual, and above all else, devotion to their supreme leader. If they didn't look so young, you might not believe they're first graders. By the time they reach elementary school, Pyongyang students have typically learned their country's most sacred lesson, shedding the individualism of youth for the collectivism of North Korean society, and most importantly, loyalty to the leader.
What do you want to be when you grow up?
I'd like to be a journalist, she says, so I can spread the greatness of the Marshal Kim Jong-un throughout the world. You'll find the same photos of the late leaders in every classroom and every home, and the same level of discipline. Even outdoor exercise is critiqued. Classes are praised for moving in unison.
Now, there are lots of interesting things that come out of this, but we're not going to delve into them too deeply right now. I'm merely laying the foundation at this particular moment. But for example, this is why you find that conservatives are very distrustful of authority in general, whereas liberals are very trusting of authority. Indeed, a study on individualism versus collectivism was conducted in 2013 by Rebecca Lefevre and Volker Frank, and they discovered that liberals score much more highly than conservatives in the key trait of dependence. So, much more dependent on this side, much more independent on this side. And it simply means that while conservatives are more likely to take issues into their own hands and assume personal responsibility for their life outcomes, liberals are far more likely to look to the government or some other kind of respected authority for guidance and for direction. So in short, they don't want to be told what to do, but they do want to be told what to do. That's a very clear differentiator between the two. They don't want to be told what to do at all sometimes. They do want to be told what to do. And we saw this distinction very clearly in response to the COVID-19 outbreak. Conservatives didn't trust the government's response. They were horrified that the government were intervening too heavily in their lives, taking their freedom through lockdowns. They didn't want to be muzzled with masks. They didn't trust the vaccines. They didn't trust the authorities' narrative on those vaccines. They wanted to basically be left alone to make their own risk assessments about the thing. On the other hand, liberals did trust the government's response, and they actively looked to the government for more guidance and for protection at all times. Liberals craved for more of that intrusion, in fact. If there was one refrain that you heard more often than any other from the liberals during COVID-19, it was that the government should have taken their freedoms earlier and harder and sooner. They wanted the government to put them into lockdown to keep them safe. They had that dependency on the government. And as fear was ramped up, liberals became more and more extreme, until hints of North Korea and China began to emerge on that side. When individuals on this side were not conforming to the group narrative on COVID, we saw a leftist impulse beginning to bubble up to eliminate those dangerous individuals who were threatening group cohesion. We saw leftists calling for people on this side who didn't conform to the group to be locked up in concentration camps, to be forced out of society, to lose their jobs, to be forced to take the vaccine against their will. We saw that impulse for authoritarianism becoming more prominent as fear drove them deeper into their trench. They saw people on this side who are not conforming as being dangerous for group unity. Again, we're not going to say anything more about this at the moment because we'll be expanding on all of this kind of stuff later. But again, we can see the basic dilemma here. Which do you prioritize? Individual freedoms or collective unity? Freedom is good, but unity is good too. But where there's personal freedom, there won't ever be true unity, and where there's total unity, there won't ever be true personal freedom. So which one should take precedence? Again, your answer to that will depend entirely on whether you're conservative or liberal.